Good afternoon. We are going to start today the final topic for this semester that I haven't covered in previous times that I taught the course. And the reason that I added it up is, of course, number one, because I do much more design for uncertainty now than I did when I taught the course last time. Four and a half years ago. The other reason is that it turns out that uncertainty is very important even when you inject it in very small doses. That is, you can get a lot of return for a minimum of investment. And so, besides teaching you the material, I hope that I'll be essentially trying to get you to use it in your own PhD research if you are not doing it already. That is, I'll hope that I'll be able to convey to you that you can get quite a bit for very little effort. So, the topic of today is a brief introduction on two things that are common to engineering design, which is number one, there is uncertainty. That is, we don't know things exactly. And number two, to counter that, we take some safety measures. And most of engineers don't think about the first part. And even most of the people that do uncertainty analysis don't think about the second part. In particular, one of the topics that my research group does more than almost anybody else in the community is look at the safety measures. So compared to what you can find in the literature, I'm going to spend a bit more time on safety measure. Now, in terms of uncertainty, we are going to look at the fact that uncertainty comes mostly in two flavors. One is due to lack of knowledge and one due to variability. And also that the safety measures that we take can happen in a lot of places. Most people think of safety measures that you do during the design, but there are safety measures that we take in manufacturing, operation, and even post-mortems. An airplane falls out of the sky, we conduct an investigation. And the second question with respect to the type of measure is, do we elect to live with the uncertainty, or do we elect to change it? And finally, I'm going to do a very brief review on how we represent uncertainties as design variables. And I'm going to remind you, in case you forgot, of the most basic things about probability distribution and their moments. So this is the plan. And since I didn't give the reading assignments last time, I thought I'll put it very early here. I put in the reference material, which is accessible only through Vista, this paper by a group of researchers from Sandia National Lab that go into more depth than I'm going to go in terms of classifying uncertainties and exploring where they come from. And one of the reasons that I didn't put it ahead of time is that it's not essential. That is, I want to encourage you to read the first page or two and then decide whether you want to read the rest of it. That is, I believe that it's very educational for an engineer to take a look at what they are doing and realize that at every step of the way, you are making errors or approximation or whatever that add to uncertainty, and this is what this paper is about. So I borrowed two figures from that paper that were borrowed in turn from some other papers. So I mentioned at the top that that's where I copied them from, but this is actually the source. And so this is the first division that is becoming very important today, and this is the fact that we have reality, we have a conceptual model. That conceptual model could be a set of differential equations that came out due to an idealization of the problem, or maybe the idealization of the problem is the conceptual model, and the differential equation is simply a mathematical way of describing it, and then you have a computer program that attempts a solution to the model that you have. And the process of going between them, from reality you go to the conceptual model through an analysis process. That is, you stipulate some. So for example, when the apple hit Newton on the head, he basically went through a mathematical assumption that everything is affected by a gravitational force, then, and there is a constant G that you can use. He later on generalized it, that if you have bodies at a distance, the gravitational attraction is proportional to the product of the masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. And you can take that and you can, for example, predict what will happen to a cannonball. That so you can have the differential equation that governs the motion of a cannonball based on this gravity. And you write a computer program that will, for example, do the trajectory of that cannonball based on this equation. Now, the process of going between the conceptual model and reality is model qualification. Before telling you what it means, I'm curious to know, what do you think it is? That is, even if English is not your native language, you have been using it for a while. So supposedly, if you saw that term, what does qualification mean? Or could mean here? One reason that I'm asking is because I have the disadvantage that I've seen those terms before, so I know exactly what they mean. It's difficult for me to see how they look to somebody who hasn't been told what they mean in this particular context. And I'm always curious about the invention of mathematical and scientific jargon. So, anybody care to tell me what they think qualification mean? Yes. Okay, so we qualify the model to see if it's adequate, and how do we do that? Yeah, so for example, we do experimental results that don't require the programming and analysis, like in case of Newton's gravitational law, we may start dropping objects from buildings at different places and measuring how long it takes them to get down. And of course, we will find that the G is not constant everywhere, but we may decide that it's close enough so that we accept the model. Then we have the process of computerizing the model, and we do that, for example, by programming. And going between the conceptual model and the computerized model, we go to a process of model verification. Could anybody tell me what you think that is? The terms verification here and validation there used to have a fairly vague meaning, and people sort of interchanged their meaning, but now they have gelled into very definite terms.
You want to make sure that the results coming from your model are reasonable and accurate.
Okay, so the results coming out from here are accurate. What do we mean by, how do we check that they are accurate? No, that's the sticky part. The comparison with the experiment is here. That is, you compare the prediction of your computer program to reality, and that's model validation. Here, reality doesn't intrude. You are walking between these two. Right. Right. That is, this is the process of checking whether your computer program reproduces results that you can derive analytically. So it's very important because this happened maybe in the past 5 years or so. That the term, it used to be that people, some people called this part validation, or they would call both part verification or validation. And in the last 5 years, the term gelled into verification being the agreement or making sure that the numerical results agree, let's say, with the differential equation, that they provide an exact solution of the differential equation. And the validation part is making sure that the model agrees reasonably well with the physical results. Now, could anybody tell me why those arrows are two-sided? No, the idea that you try to convey here is that when they don't agree, you go and improve. So, when they don't agree, you go back here. I'm sorry, you go back here and you you change, you find a bug in your computer program, let's say. Okay, so this is one view of reality, and here is a much more complicated view. Again, it came from the same paper by Oberkamp, but he took it in terms by, from a paper by Jacobi and Kowalik. And it says, actually, reality is much more complicated. you have some reason to model something, you know, like you want to find out how long what would be the trajectory of a cannonball. And then you'll be create a prototype analysis. For example, you may decide to neglect the air resistance. And you'll do an analysis and you'll have a preliminary model and you'll apply to it the mathematical analysis, and you'll get the math model that describes the trajectory. And you'll need some solution techniques and computer program and model and modeling results. And you'll find out that they don't agree, so you'll go back around and improve things. Now, one of the things that you know, the arrows point out to many different places where things can go wrong. Like you have your debugging, and most people realize that almost all the big computer programs that you are using are full of bugs, okay? That is, if you are using Abacus, you can bet your last dime that Abacus has bugs in it, and if you are using some CFD code, it's even more likely because those codes are typically less mature than those finite element programs. And it's just that the really bad bugs have been found out, while what's left are either bugs that show themselves very infrequently, that is, you have to have very special kind of circumstances, or they are responsible for very small errors, so they've never been found. So another example is solution technique. Even if Abacus doesn't have a bug, it may use a solution technique that even if you throw at it a million finite elements, will still give you the wrong results, but maybe not by much. Or somebody changed the compiler or the system that you run Abacus on, and all of a sudden that introduced a bug. So all of those opportunities, and this paper takes you into that and give you an example from some applications, and that's what I want to do. Instead, I'm going to make life simple and focus only on two broad categories of uncertainty, because that makes it easy to think about them, and all of those more minor divisions fall broadly into that. And so here is the jargon that I expect you to remember, and this is the division into aleatory uncertainty and epistemic uncertainty. Now, since the word aleatory and epistemic are not something that you are going to use in everyday conversation, and if you use uncertainty in your research, it still be good that you'll be able to describe it to your girlfriends, parents, siblings, friends who are not into uncertainty analysis, then you want to think of aleatory uncertainty as inherent variability. That is, inherent essentially means that things just don't repeat themselves, and there is nothing that you can do about it. So you can have the question, what does regular unleaded costs in Gainesville? And if somebody asks you that question, you may tell them that the number for today is 225 plus or minus 10 cents. You are basically telling them that you cannot give them more accurate information, because when they drive around in Gainesville, they are going to see prices that are going to be different, and the only thing that you can tell them is either the mean and the standard deviation, or the range, or If you are really expert, you may have constructed the probability distribution, but that's it. It's not that you don't know the answer more precisely. There is no more precise answer. And then you have epistemic uncertainty, which essentially is lack of knowledge. And the example is, what would be the average cost of regular unleaded on January 1st? That is in about 5 weeks. Again, you may tell somebody that your best prediction is that it's going to be $2.25 plus or minus 10 cents. So notice that possibly you can give somebody the same answer to this question and to this question. That is, in both cases, you'll say $2.25 plus or minus 10 cents. I'm not saying that it's the most reasonable answer, but conceivably, both answers could happen to be the same. And so it's very important to note the fact that there is a difference. Now, could anybody tell me if you ask those two questions and you get the same answer, you go to the same person that is responsible for conducting surveys of gas prices in Gainesville, and you ask them the first question, what is the price today? And he says 225 plus minus 10 cents. You ask them, what do you expect the price to be on January 1st? And he'll say $2.25 plus minus 10 cents. What difference between the two answers you see that strikes you the most, even though word for word, that is, do you see any difference in the information which is conveyed? Anybody?
One is a prediction,
okay.
The other one is based on
actual data that you have right now. Okay, so let me change, you are absolutely right, Oscar. One is a prediction and one is based on the data right now. So let's say that I asked that person instead, what's the price in Miami today? What's the average price in Miami today? And he said, I'm not sure, but my guess is that it's $2.25 plus or minus 10 cents. That, it turns out that that is now, no prediction, but still the essential difference is the same. So anybody sees any other? Yeah.
The first one is you can get the information, but you did not get it. But the second one is you cannot anyway get the information, even if you want it.
No, I mean, you can call Miami and get.
Yeah, that's right. That is what you can obtain.
Oh, you mean the second one, you can obtain the information. So one important distinction is in the second case, there is a better right answer. That is, you can get the average price of gasoline in Miami today, while in the first case, that's the best answer that you can get, even if you knew the gas prices at every station in Gainesville, which actually the assumption is that this person does know that. Any other distinction between those two answers? Yes.
Think about the price on a specific day. The price can be an exact number, you don't need a range.
No, you do need a range, you know. Just this morning I passed about 5 gas stations and each one of them had a different price.
But it's up to the average cost. So this
is the second one.
Yeah.
So you can get an exact answer. The reason that you give a range is because you don't know what this exact answer is. Now, the reason that I'm spending so much time on the distinction between the two is the tools that are used to analyze it. Everybody agrees that to model this type of uncertainty, probability distributions are the right way to go. But there is a war going on this one. For example, Dr. Oberkamp, who is the first author on the paper that I put for you to read in, wrote some papers where he expressed the belief and explained the tools that you can use, theories that are go under evidence theories that you would use better for this case, while people that do probability for a living will tell you that in terms of the tools, you don't care at all whether the uncertainty reflects your lack of knowledge or whether the uncertainty reflects the inherent variability. I tend to subscribe mostly to the second view, that you just need to know what you are modeling, but the tools via probability distributions are possible. One of the refinements that you sometimes use for that is something which is called upper and lower probabilities. That is, instead of just giving one probability distribution, you give a range. Now, the thing which is most confusing is the fact that the distinction between the two is not absolute, in that as you gain more knowledge, what appeared to be inherent variability can be reduced. So for example, if I studied gas prices in Gainesville at every station in Gainesville, which I do to some extent because I need to make decisions where I buy gas, I can tell that certain stations are usually substantially lower than the average, and certain stations are higher than average. And so if instead of measuring the scatter from the average gas in Gainesville, I would say I'm going to take the average in Gainesville and then I'm going to correct for each station that I know, adding 1% up, 2% down, and so on. All of a sudden, this inherent scatter will go substantially lower. I would like you to tell me how that can happen for G. Okay, that is, we go and measure G in many experiments, and we see a certain scatter. How can improved knowledge reduce the scatter? Another way of looking at it, what factors that account for some of this factor can we analyze so that instead of predicting that G is the same everywhere, we will actually be predicting that it's slightly different, and therefore the scatter that we'll measure is not from this constant value, but from these different values. Anybody? So can you give me an example of where you can predict that two people did an experiment measuring the acceleration of gravity and they got answers that are different, and you can say, yes, I predict that this person will get a higher value than that person. Altitude. Okay, so somebody in Colorado can be expected to measure a smaller value of G than we do in Florida. Okay, what else? So we can correct for altitude. If we measure G at sea level on all the oceans in the globe, we'll find that the values are different. What do you think is the major difference? Let me tell you that it depends on latitude. Well, contrary to popular belief, Earth is not a sphere. So it's somewhat squashed so that the radius is higher at the equator than at the pole. So we would expect to find, so more or less we will find differences in G going monotonically as we go from the equator to the pole. I have to admit that I forgot which one is higher. That is, the radius is higher at the equator, and I think that means the G is smaller, but I'm not 100% sure. Okay, so this is very important to think that the word inherent should be put in quotes. Now, in terms of designing structures, my students usually adopt a different split of uncertainty, which is mostly epistemic and mostly aleatory, but not precisely that. We classify them as error and variability, where error is mostly epistemic and variability is mostly aleatory. So let's look. Instead, we use the definition of error as the departure of the average fleet of an aircraft model from the ideal. That is the key distinction that we make is that when you design something, people are not going to implement it in the field all the same, and even if they build exact replicas of what you designed, they will be operated under different conditions. So what you design and what will happen will have differences. And one difference comes due to the fact that you make errors. And so this is the departure from the ideal. And one is due to the fact that those copies of the structure that you design are going to be all different from one another. And so in the errors, we include things that most people will call errors, and this is errors in predicting structural failure, construction errors, but I include also deliberate changes. That is, somebody on the production line of the Boeing 747 get the news that the material supplier that they've used for years just went bankrupt, and they are going to switch instead to some material which is not exactly according to design specification, but it's 0.5%. You know, the Young modulus is 0.5% difference or whatever, and they say, small enough, no need to bother about it, so they go ahead and do that. So people do that all the time. That, yes. Right. So the error is the term which is applied to the average specimen in the fleet. The difference between them we can count as variability. So, for example, I gave you the deliberate changes in material property, but the change in the average material property could be due to the fact that the supplier has tested 20 specimens of that material and calculated the average as being 10 million PSI for the Young modulus. But when they supply 10,000 batches of material, the true average is, instead of being 10 million, it's 9.95 million. So this is still an error due to the fact that you measured things inaccurately. One reason that we prefer to classify that way is, if you think about it, when you try to compensate for uncertainty, different treatment are called for something that affects the entire fleet to something that affects individual specimen of that fleet. Could anybody describe to me a very simple, well, I say example, testing and simulation to improve math model and the solution. So Boeing may decide to include in their finite element model of that airplane nonlinear analysis. I think that I mentioned that to you some time ago, instead of linear analysis. That reduces the error. Could anybody give me an example of error reduction, not on the part of the engineer who is designing the, who is doing a finite element analysis of the airplane, but on somebody, totally different person that has control over errors? I'm sorry?
Measurement of material properties.
Okay, but I'm looking for a person.
Manufacturing.
Yeah, so the manufacturing people can apply very tight tolerances so that the specimen that they get from the designer on average are very accurate. Anybody from the government that can reduce errors?
Inspection.
Okay. So, I'm sorry?
Calculation,
right? You know, Boeing submits their calculation to the FAA, and the FAA does it. Anything that you personally can do? You can develop better math models for Boeing to use, right? If you think about the fact that many of you, or at least your fellow students and professor, are constantly engaging in that prospect. Okay, so now variability. So you can improve tooling, construction, and quality control. Those measures have some effect on errors, but they also reduce variability between airplanes. Oscar mentioned, I think, inspections. And those inspections compensate for the variability between airplanes. Instead, they catch those airplanes that, because of some mistakes, had different properties. What does the personnel department at Boeing can do to reduce variability between airplanes? What do you mean by consistency on the part of the personnel department?
Make sure that everything is consistent.
No, no. I'm sorry?
Not hiring, firing frequently.
Yeah, well, what I was looking for is simply training. Okay, that is you train workers to do better jobs. What does United Airlines can do to reduce variability? Yeah, so they can train their pilots to fly the airplane the way it was intended to, so that you'll have less variability because of the difference in the way pilots fly the airplane. So the bottom line is that the safety measures, which are the countermeasures that you take to counter the uncertainty, can be applied at four stages, at least. The first stage being in the design. You can use conservative loads, you can use conservative material properties, you can improve the accuracy of the model, and then you submit it to the government and they certify your design. The manufacturer people can do quality control, and they can again have oversight by the FAA, for example. The operation, you have licensing of operators, maintenance and inspection, and the post-mortem is accident investigations. How do accident investigations reduce uncertainty and improve safety? So how does that reduces uncertainty or improve safety? Yeah, so it's not only future failures, but it improves the safety of the fleet. That is one Boeing, which one was it? 767, I think, the last one that crashed, falls out of the sky. And you find something about the Boeing 767 and you issue warning bulletins or better practice bulletins to everybody that flies Boeing 767, or you change a part or whatever. And so this airplane that fell out of the sky because of the post-mortem acts sort of like the sacrificial lamb. It is destroyed for the benefit of all the other airplanes of the same model. I'm sorry? Right. Exactly. companies like Boeing actually have a fleet leaders. Even before they start selling airplane, they have an airplane that flies a lot to try and see if something is going to go wrong after 10,000 hours of flight, so that they can warn everybody else about whatever it is. So, because people don't think so much about it, there is a very large number of people whose business it is to reduce uncertainty and improve safety. And to the best of my knowledge, Dr. Kim and myself are thinking about writing a proposal to NSF to remedy this deficiency. Nobody seems to ask whether your dollars are better spent in terms of improving safety if you spend them at NASA, at Boeing, at the FAA, or maybe a subsidies to the airlines. So the government gives us money to develop more accurate models. Boeing invests their time, you know, like the transition from linear to nonlinear analysis probably cost them quite a bit of money. And they invest in the accuracy of the manufacturing, they do tests. Airline invest in maintenance and inspection. FAA invest in certification of airplanes and pilots. And then the NTSB, in collaboration with the FAA and NASA, do those accident investigations. Now, as I said, to the best of my knowledge, there are no numbers on the return per dollar at each one of those stages. Not only that, I don't even know how to rank them. That is, where are we getting the most return? Forget about the numbers. Just being able to tell which is number one and which is the last one, I don't have the vaguest idea. So this seems to be a somewhat unfortunate state of affairs, but you can see that none of those agencies, unless they have some reason to believe that they are the best, has a vested interest in finding out. They may find out that they are grossly overfunded. Okay, so this was basically a very general background on two aspects of uncertainties. What kind of uncertainties and what do we do about it? What I expect that you got somewhere in your education before you came here is the knowledge of random variables. And I basically says that those are variables that can take multiple values with probability assigned to each value. Could anybody give me an example of a random variable? I'm sorry? Gas prices. Okay. I'm sorry?
Crack size.
Okay. If you look around you, do you see any random variables?
Attendance,
okay. So here is something which is very important. Whether a variable is random or not depends on your outlook. Okay, that is, you can say that the number of people that come to the class is a random variable changing between such, and it has this particular distribution. Or you can say it's not random at all. At any given day, I know exactly how many people came to class, so what's random about it? So this is the part where knowledge sometimes changes the randomness. The measures that we are going to use in the rest of the semester to talk about it is probability distribution function, cumulative distribution function, mean, variance, standard deviation, and coefficient of variation. If any of those terms is alien to you or you don't remember what it is, do yourself and me a favor and look it up, because we are not going to spend a lot of time reviewing what it is, since I assume that you had it before. And so this is the amount of statistics jargon that I expect you to have at this point. Any questions?
Yes. What is the definition of certificate of design?
The FAA, for example, when Boeing submit to it the design of a new, let's say, they'll be submitting the 787, and the FAA will certify that design to begin with. You know, they look at the paper, and then they'll actually certify the airplane itself by testing it or watching over the test that Boeing will do. Other questions?
Since you can't predict how many people are going to be in the next class,
Yeah, so it all boils down to the fact of how do you pose the question? Okay, so it's not a variable that is random or not. It becomes random or not depending on what question you ask about it. Other questions? Okay, that will be all.